We're in Lisbon. This is where my record was born.
I came to Lisbon because of my son, because of his passion for playing football. That's how it all began. I was a soccer mom.
Whilst I was happy to be out of America, to look at the world through another point of view, I started to feel frustrated as an artist. I'm quite lonely. I didn't really know anybody. I felt the same way when I first came to New York when I was 19 years old. I knew that I had to find my tribe, so to speak. I started asking around, where's the music? I've always been a huge fan of Fado music and Morna. I've been following Cesaria Evora since I was a teenager. Eventually, I got an invitation to a living room session. It's a place where musicians and singers gather. People sit in someone's home and drink wine and play music. What struck me the most was this kind of organic, authentic feeling of people being there really because they just love music. Money had nothing to do with it. Fame had nothing to do with it. Instagram followers had nothing to do with it. It was really about passion and music and art. I met an incredible human being, a very generous soul named Dino de Santiago, and he started to introduce me to everybody. It wasn't just Fado and Morna anymore. Funana, music of Angola. At that moment, I went, oh my God, I have to take what I'm hearing and I have to turn it upside down. And then I started to film the music. I took some of the video clips that I filmed and I sent them to Mirwes, who is a collaborator, a co-writer, a co-producer that I've worked with on many of my records in the past, as you know. Mirwes, I know this is crazy. Tell me if it inspires you. Let's chop up the guitar sounds. Let's give it some modern sounding drums. Within a week, he sent me back music. And it was amazing. And I felt super inspired. At that moment, I went, oh my God, I'm very happy to be here for David's football career, but this is why I'm here. I'll do this while I'm waiting to raise money for my film and for my children to come home from school.
Will we know when to stop?
I had landed in a magical world. I moved to New York when I was 19. I started dancing. I went to the Martha Graham School, and there was a uniform. I don't know why, but as soon as somebody tells me there's a rule, I have to break it. I started to do little small things to what I was wearing. Tears and holes in my stockings. Little by little, I was getting into trouble with the teacher, and this pleased me enormously. Of course, I wanted to be noticed for my dancing, but I wanted to stand out as a renegade. Then I said, clothes are not enough. I've got to change my hair. I went to Harlem and I got my hair cornrowed. At that point, I was called to the office. I was breaking too many rules, and if I didn't follow the dress code, then I would be asked to leave. Then there was a knock at the door. The door opened, in walked Martha Graham with her long black gloves and her incredibly beautiful but intimidating face. She said, we have rules and we have regulations. And I said, but if you followed the rules, you wouldn't be where you are today. You changed the way everybody looked at classical dance and you took off the tutus. You empowered women. And she said, you're right. But if everybody thinks the way that you think, then there's going to be no order here. She said, I'm going to give you a new name, Madam X. Every day you come to school and I don't recognize you. Every day you change your identity. You're a mystery to me. And I said, good. Thank you. People have always said that I reinvent myself all the time, change my identity, my looks. I thought back to that conversation that I had with Martha Graham. I decided to call my record Madame X.
I wasn't lost.
Madame X is a secret agent.
I am Madame X.
Traveling around the world, changing identities, fighting for freedom.
Freedom.
Bringing light to dark places.
I bring light to dark places.
Madame X is a dancer.
I'm a dancer.
A professor. A head of state. A housekeeper. An equestrian. A prisoner. A student. A mother. A child. A teacher. A nun. A singer. A saint.
A whore.
A whore. I'm a spy. In the house of love. I'm Madame X.
We're making music in Portugal. I'm hearing music from Cabo Verde and music from Spain and music from Brazil. I recognize that really it's all connected. You could call it world music, but it's our music. It's the music of the soul of the universe. If we're lucky enough, we can tap into it, draw from it, give voice to it, share it with the world. More than other records in the past, it's a much more intimate record, even though it's about universal topics, big topics like gun control, fighting for the rights of the LGBTQ community, women's rights, and having the right to have a say about what happens to their bodies. It's universal, but intimate at the same time. Real intimacy has to be earned. Right now, especially with social media, giving us this illusion that we're all connected and that we all have this instant connection to people, actually, we have no connection to people. I spent all night waiting up. And Instagram is a lie. I mean, it's fun. And as long as you accept that it's fun and it's not the truth, nothing against technology, because I love technology. I love voices that don't sound human, and I like making things sound robotic. But there always has to be some essence of humanity in everything that I do. And I'd like to think that no matter what, if all the electricity got unplugged and we ran out of oil and we ran out of everything, I could still sit with a candle, play my guitar and sing my song, and nobody could get in the way with that. 'Cause you're driving me crazy. You must think I'm crazy. Você me põe tão louca. Você pensa que eu sou louca. No matter what horrible things we do to one another as human beings, the one thing that keeps us connected, the one thing that lifts us up, the one thing that gives us hope is music. So the very first song that I wrote is called Killers Who Are Partying. We have all of these powerful men positioned in places all around the world who are all celebrating and abusing their power while minorities are suffering, being degraded. And me saying that I will take on the burdens of all marginalized people. The civil rights that we fought for, the LGBTQ community, the women's rights, like everything started to go backwards, and I felt that it was really important to reflect my rage, my sense of betrayal. There's something about Fado and also Morna. There's a kind of melancholy and a kind of sadness. It was a perfect palette for me to paint from, so to speak. Another really important song on this record is Batuka. How did I discover the Batucaderas? Dino de Santiago, my musical connection in Lisbon, he said, you have to come and hear these women play. They're gonna blow your mind. And they are a force of female empowerment and energy and passion. Went to this tiny little club in the middle of nowhere. There was a circle of women sitting in these chairs, and this music started, and these women were all playing. They took turns standing up and singing solos and also singing in Creole and dancing. It was so inspiring. So after I saw them perform, I said, oh my gosh, Dino, would it be possible to do a song, to collaborate with them? And he approached them and they said yes. And so then we ended up in the recording studio, made a song. It's a long way. It's a long way. It's a long way. It's a long way. It's a call and response song. We all sat in a room together. We recorded it live. They were amazing. And it was a religious experience. Even my children were there singing along with them. It was just a total celebration of life. You could feel the matriarchal power of these women. You could feel history. You could feel sadness. And you could feel, most importantly, joy. I've used the word sorrow and sadness and melancholy a lot. There's a lot of joy here in Portugal. And that is the paradox of art and music and life. Portugal was the birthplace of slavery. Cabo Verde was the first place where the slave ships came from Africa, and these women came from that place. So I feel like their music and the things they had to say, and I feel like even if it was not even conscious, that it was coming out of them, the past, the present, and the future. It's about the journey. It's always about the journey. Out of darkness comes light. You can hold people down and you can keep people down and you can put them in shackles and you can put all sorts of restrictions on a human being, but you cannot take their soul away from them.
It's a beautiful life.
Dark Ballet. That's a song that was inspired by Joan of Arc.
It's a beautiful dream.
She fought the English. She won. And still, they were not happy. Still, they judged her.
I can dress like a boy.
They said she was a man. They said she was a lesbian. They said she was a witch. And in the end, they burned her at the stake. And she feared nothing. And I admire that. Also incorporating the idea of Tchaikovsky. Every time I watch The Nutcracker Suite, I don't know why it's this popular ballet for children, because to me, I find it very scary and weird. And also one of my favorite filmmakers, who is Stanley Kubrick, A Clockwork Orange, which is a very nihilistic film. And dark ballet is kind of the dance we're all dancing right now in this world, the dark ballet. Yeah.
It's a beautiful life.
God control. It's about gun control. How easy it is to buy a gun in America, and it's really so scary. People feel like they are God when they are holding a gun. They think that they are above the law of cause and effect. But as you know, I like to juxtapose things. The basis of a song is the cascading strings of disco music from the late 70s. Because when I first moved to New York, it was 1979. I went to Studio 54. The disco ball and all the beautiful people dancing, everybody's snorting cocaine. And so I tried to bring the world of disco and freedom and having that joy silenced by the idea that people can just go to a Walmart and minimal amount of identification buy a small thing made of metal that can end someone's life.
It's just a really scary time. Guns need to be made illegal.
So many fans in Brazil, I can't just sing songs for Portugal. I have to make. Yes, so there are no coincidences. I ended up meeting the singer Anita, who is very well known in Brazil. And so we decided to work together on a song, but Brazilian Portuguese is very different than Portuguese Portuguese. So then I had to relearn the language all over again, and everything that Dino taught me got thrown out the window. And yeah, and I had to drink a little bit more wine. But that's another one of my collaborators. My other collaborators, Quavo from the Migos and Diplo, who I've worked with many times in the past, we brought in the Jamaican dancehall vibes. I'm really excited about that song, Future. It's a song about the world that we live in today.
My life is gold, I drip my eyes.
Quavo's singing about something important and deep and about the future of our civilization. Obviously, he has a very young following, and it's important for his fans to hear what he has to say and what he thinks about the state of the world today. I met Maluma backstage at an award show, and slow down, Poppy. We started talking. We said, hey, let's work together. And the next thing you know, we were texting each other and talking about working in the studio, and we ended up writing two songs together. One's called Medellin, and it's about the city that Maluma is from. And another one is called Bitch, I'm Loca. Yes, you can figure that one out yourself. And of course, I don't speak Spanish, so I had to have Spanish lessons. Spanish is easier than Portuguese, I'd like to point that out. Two really fun songs.
So nice to meet you, Mrs. Crazy. Where do you want me to put this?
You can put it inside.
I wrote this song, I Rise, as a way of giving a voice to all marginalized people, people who don't have the opportunity to speak their mind, people who are in jail, incarcerated, bullied, beaten, abused, whether you're gay or a woman, a Native American Indian, whatever religion, all people who feel that they are being oppressed. Another reason I wrote it is because this is the 50th anniversary of Gay Pride this year, and I hope that this will become an anthem for the LGBTQ community, that this song gives people hope and courage to be who they are and to not be afraid to be who they are and to speak their mind and to love themselves, because you can't love other people unless you love yourself. I have a song called Come Alive that was inspired by music of North Africa. It's called Ganawa. I listened to that a lot, and what I loved the most about the music was the percussion instruments in it, which are called krakev. There's an interesting story. The shackles that the slaves wore so that they couldn't escape. Once they were free, they turned what enslaved them into music. And they made those krakevs. I wanted to bring that instrument back into the story. Another song that was inspired very specifically by Morna is a song called Extreme Occident, and it's really about my travels around the world, my search for my own identity. I come from the Midwest, but I travel to the Far East. Everywhere I go, I'm inspired by not only the people, but the cultures and the music. Art belongs to everyone. It's not a question of appropriating what other people do and taking it as your own. For me, it's an homage to all the music that I've listened to and giving a platform and a voice to all of this incredible music that the rest of the world doesn't really have the privilege to hear and listen to. India was once colonized by the Portuguese, so there's a section very influenced by the music of Rajasthan and tabla music. That's another connection to Lisbon, Portugal.
I won't let you drive me crazy.
Stara, she's an incredible writer. And another song that I wrote with Stara that I love on the record is called Crazy. And I sing Portuguese in that. Can we just talk about how hard it is to speak Portuguese? Well, because yes, you guys, it's just, I mean, you just invented a language that's almost impossible to speak. I want props.
No, big props. She did the whole thing, like, fast flows.
No, I didn't. I felt a great sense of accomplishment, but I also felt like it was important to sing in Portuguese. It's kind of a love song, which is a little bit strange for me. I don't know. What is love?
I won't let you drive me crazy.
Loca. Okay, you loca fritas, I'm going to bed.